All right. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us for our April installment of our Outdoor Florida webinar series. I'm just going to go ahead and give everyone a minute or two to get all situated, get joined in, get their audio connected, so we're all ready to start. All right, well, it looks like everyone's in. Like I said, thank you again for joining us for our April installment of our Outdoor Florida webinar series. Today, we're having Felicia Boyd speak with us from the Timaquan Foundation. Felicia is the Program and Outreach Director for the Timaquan Parks Foundation. And for the past 20 years, Felicia's been involved with developing and implementing environmental education programs and recruiting volunteers and citizen groups to kind of help work with that, to help work with outdoor projects. Felicia is a professional geologist from Jacksonville, where she and her husband have three adult children, and in their free time, and she's a woman after my own heart, they love camping, hiking, backpacking, and canoeing, which are all things I think we all enjoy. So I'm really excited to have Felicia speak with us today about their Passport to Health initiative and everything going on at the Timaquan Parks Foundation. So without making you wait any further, I'm going to pass it off to Felicia so she can get started.
Thank you, Michaela. So we are very excited to be here. Jacksonville always gets short shrift. And so we are here today to introduce you to what Jacksonville has to offer in the way of outdoor recreation. I'm going to start with a video that we have on our Timaquan Parks Foundation website. And I'll mention this again at the end, but I would encourage you to visit that website. It has all the parks you can visit. It has the programming that we're doing, and we're actually getting ready to switch to a new website, so we're kind of excited about that. So I'm going to start with this quick little video. Oop, that doesn't look like a video. That looks like a PowerPoint. Okay.
Jacksonville. A vibrant city surrounded by wildlife and abundant natural beauty. For 20 years, the Timaquan Parks Foundation has worked to preserve that beauty, ensuring it can be enjoyed for generations to come. Thousands of acres of preserved land make ours the largest urban park system in the United States, and one destined to become the crown jewel of Northeast Florida. With these parks, we aren't just creating a place for adventure and exploration. We're creating a sense of place, of well-being, of a desire to learn, and to protect what is precious. Through education and passion, we are a national model for cooperation and conservation. Watching with pride as Jacksonville becomes known throughout the nation for the lands it chose to protect. In the end, our society will be defined not only by what we create, but by what we refuse to destroy. Join us, TimaquanParks.org.
All right. So today, we're going to talk about the Timaquan Parks Foundation and our parks in the context of fresh air, fitness, friendship, and fun. So we could talk about parks and their value, their intrinsic value of how they help with mitigating the effects of climate change, or we could talk about their economic value if you happen to live next door to a park. But my favorite subject and what I want to talk about today is the recreational use of these parks and how we can use parks and outdoor spaces to address issues of equity and health. So according to the CDC, only 25% of adults get the recommended daily physical activity, and they're 29% engage in no leisure time physical activity at all. So this, of course, leads to issues of obesity and high blood pressure and heart disease. But studies have shown, of course, that parks can provide unique opportunities to improve that physical and mental health. You can go for a walk in your neighborhood, but studies have shown that if you walk in the woods, you have, you know, it's better for your health. So fortunately for us in Jacksonville, this is a map of Duval County, or Jacksonville, which takes up the entire county. We have all these little green spaces that are parks. We have the National Park Service has the Timaquan Ecological and Historic Preserve, which is up in this northeast corner, northeast corner, 46,000 acres of, it's kind of like Acadia National Park, where you have private lands, we got a lot of salt marsh, we have some state parks, and then you have these national park pieces. We have Fort Caroline National Memorial, Kingsley Plantation, Cedar Point Preserve, Theodore Roosevelt area. We'll talk more about those later. We have world famous state parks, Little Talbot Island, Big Talbot Island State Park. And then we have these city preservation parks that ring the county. We call them our wilderness parks. Jacksonville has over 400 parks. A lot of them are, you know, ball fields and little neighborhood parks. We're going to focus today on what we, like I said, what we're calling our wilderness parks, or these preservation parks. Jacksonville has over 130 square miles of parks and preserves. One thing I want to mention before we go on is that every picture that I'm going to show today is in Jacksonville, Florida. And, you know, they're accessible to anyone. 130 square miles is like three Disney Worlds. So it's large, spread out throughout the county. 1,100 miles of tributary water access, river access, and the Atlantic coast, so the beaches. And then 120 miles of upland trails. And these are developed trails like this that you can actually see where there's a trail and you can walk it. So places to go hiking or walking. I like this picture because anybody can take advantage of these trails. Most of our parks are free. The National Park Service sites that we have here are free. The state parks are $5. We have a couple of regional city parks that are $5. But most of our parks are free and open dawn to dusk. I like this because you can go walking, you can be tall, you can be short, you can be young, you can be old, you can be black, you can be white, you can bring your, you don't even have to be human, you can bring your dog. So it's accessible for anyone. We have several paved trails as well as boardwalks for those who have mobility issues. So hiking and biking, we have on-road biking. There are a couple of different places. One is the Jacksonville Ballroom Rail Trail. We have a 14.5-mile rail trail here that runs from close to downtown all the way to the town of Baldwin. We like to tell people, you know, people are saying, what can I do for a day in Jacksonville? We say, bring your bike, go to Camp Milton Historic Preserve, which is about halfway on the rail trail. Ride your bike to Baldwin, go into the town of Baldwin, get catfish dinner, go to everybody's restaurant, hop on your bike and bike back to Camp Milton. And so this is like every other rail trail, you have these long stretches that you don't have to worry about getting run over. We also have a trail up on the northeast corner that runs up Big Talbot Island. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. A lot of off-road trails, most of our trails through the woods are accessible by it doesn't even have to be a fancy road bike. I have a little hybrid and I can ride most of them. Hanna Park is kind of the most famous one for its biking, but really we have a lot of other trails that you can just hop on your bike and ride. This area, Cedar Point Preserve, is part of the newly branded Seven Creeks Recreation Area. We had a big festival there last weekend, or a couple weekends ago, but other than that, most people haven't discovered it yet. So you can go out there and ride and not see very many people. So hiking and biking, boating, you can places to go kayaking, canoeing, jet ski out in the Intercoastal Waterway or in the ocean. We have a lot of beach properties, and so just going to the beach to go swimming or surfing or digging in sand. Camping, we have sites that you can bring your RV. We have sites that you can set up a tent. We have primitive sites that you can set up a tent, and there are, you know, it's, like I said, it's fairly primitive with maybe just a restroom, but not shower facilities. Or we go all the way up to cabins. This one is a wheelchair accessible cabin at Hanna Park. Wildlife viewing. Between now and June is a great time to go to Huguenot Memorial Park and see the nesting royal terns. That's always fun. They block off the beach so that you can't drive on the beach. That's the only beach you can drive on. And you can walk down to where the birds are nesting, and there's always photographers there with their spotting scopes, and they will let you look through their scopes, and you can see the birds all up close and personal. Again, more birds, but there's also gopher tortoises, of course, dolphins in the St. John's River. Almost any time you go out in the river, you're going to see dolphins. And of course, other wildlife. Fishing is another recreational sport. I like this particular photo because it shows kids fishing. It shows kids outdoors. And again, the health benefits of getting kids away from the screens and outdoors where they can be loud and they can... we can ask them to be quiet and listen to the birds, but they're just getting that fresh air and different experiences. Yoga, we do yoga on the beach, we do yoga in the park. So a lot of physical, opportunities to get physically active and improve your physical health, but then also your mental health. A lot of these parks are, they're virtually undeveloped, so you can go out, sit on a log, watch the clouds go by, and just de-stress. So the Timaquan Parks Foundation, I'm the Program and Outreach Director. We are a small nonprofit that our mission is to preserve, promote, enhance Jacksonville's natural areas through community engagement, education, and enjoyment. We support and collaborate with our Timaquan Trail State and National Park partners, which is the National Park Service, Florida State Parks, and City of Jacksonville. That's an unusual collaboration to have those entities work together and convene, and they have as the Timaquan Trail State and National Parks, and we are their nonprofit friends group. We also partner with a lot of community organizations to promote environmental stewardship, the health benefits of the parks, and an appreciation for Jacksonville's special outdoor spaces. We do a lot of, since day one, we've supported our park partners, and we have a robust volunteer program where we do trail maintenance and invasive plant removals. We do shoreline cleanups, planting, light construction projects, build boardwalks. We use the opportunity, this is a picture of high schoolers need their community service hours. So, we offer opportunities for them to come out for some events. During COVID, we couldn't do any all calls. And so we set up a kind of a student self-guided program where students go to our website, they pick a park, they go out, they pick up trash for a couple of hours, they go back to the website, fill out a form that they give a description of the trash they found and a little reflection of their experience, and they send some photos, and then we send them their certificate for 2 hours of community service. And then we pick a student once a week to receive a May Day's ice cream card. And so that's kind of helped to keep some of our parks. There's several students that go regularly to one or two parks, and that helps keep that trash cleaned up on a routine basis. We also have a Timaquan Parks Foundation trail team that started out small during COVID, but it's grown to, we probably every week we have a project, and we have 15 to 20, mostly retirees, but some UNF and FSCJ college interns that come out and help. We're clearing a historic brick road. We do trail maintenance. We've created a trail, or we do some of the deep cleaning type stuff that you won't necessarily want to send students out to do, but we removed 63 tires from the back of one of the older parks. So that's been an exciting program. We help our park partners with youth education, mostly talking about water quality or what kind of animals, what kind of biological and interests there might be. We also have a lot of historical sites, and so we do a lot of tours with that. And we do trail explorations where we'll take different groups out for walks. Several years ago, and we'll talk about this, we'll talk about how we decided that, we were always talking to the same people. We were always talking to people who'd like to go or know about hiking and biking and boating and fishing and kayaking and canoeing. But we realized there was a whole nother audience that we could talk to about using the parks to get healthy. We also realized that everybody in the picture looked the same. They were pretty much middle-aged white people, men and women, but and mostly men, some women. And so we decided we needed to expand our outreach to reach those audiences that didn't know about our parks. It would help with the stewardship of our parks. And as we all know, if people are not aware that these places exist or what opportunities there are or give them any kind of access to these places or reason to go, they won't care about them and these places will go away. So a few years, we started out with a health program, a health initiative, where we were going to reach out to some non-traditional audiences just to see who we could bring in to introduce these parks to. So we started out by connecting with the health community. We started going to some health conferences so that we'd let the health community know that we were there, that our parks were a health venue for both physical, to improve both physical and mental health. And that was great because we were able to make connections with Humana and other organizations that could help connect us with those communities that needed opportunities to get healthy. We convened a therapeutic parks advisory group with doctors from Borland Groover, Brooks Rehab, Jacksonville University and UNF, the Mayo Clinic, and then we brought in our parks partners. We started out by bringing them in to help us with some park design. We have a park, Castaway Island Preserve, which is just up the road from Mayo Clinic. So we said, well, how can we redesign this park to make it more comfortable and accessible for patients and their caregivers? What kind of parking? How can we improve the parking? How can we improve the trails? Where do we need to put benches, water stations, the defibrillator? Places like this where you have this great little overlook, but In July, it's hotter than blazes. So, you know, what kind of shelters do we need to put in place? And again, water stations. We were mostly focusing on wellness to start with. We have our Passport to Health, which is just a little pamphlet that UNF intern helped us put together. And it has some of the parks with a little map of the park. And then it couches the park in terms of, you know, how can you get healthy? If you hike this 3.5 mile loop, you'll burn 130 calories. And then it also told about the trails, whether you could take a stroller, how accessible it was, if you're in a wheelchair. And so that was, this is a really fun little booklet again to take. We've been talking about starting an RX program where doctors actually prescribe the outdoors or going to a park for their patients instead of just prescribing some kind of pills or this particular program is it's more complicated than just saying to the doctor, oh, please prescribe these parks. If the doctors haven't been to those parks, they're not going to prescribe them. A lot of our preservation parks are on the outskirts of the county, and so there may be a 20-minute drive. So we need to work with bus transportation to get people to the parks. So that program is kind of in the works. We've also had our students, our interns, write up papers, research papers on natural therapeutic spaces. How can parks be used to help with your mental health? Again, we worked with Humana. They have a Go365 program, which is a employee wellness program. You get an app on your phone. If you go to Bailey's Gym, it pings your phone, you get 10 points. If you walk your 10,000 steps, it pings your phone, you get 10 points. So we put these, we worked with Humana to put these in every one of our parks so people could go to our parks and get their 10 points. And people get really nice things for these points, like Amazon gift cards and flat screen TVs. So we're looking to expand this to other insurance companies and their wellness programs. By far the most exciting piece of the health and the most fun for me is our community outreach and wellness program, reaching out to those non-traditional audiences to get them specifically out, you know, to put together fun programming or projects to get them out to the parks. So working with urban teens to bring them out kayaking and fishing and doing fun projects, working with seniors to do service projects, you know, using their skills, seniors and veterans to help you know, some of our park maintenance. We started with seniors. Seniors suffer from loneliness and isolation. They sit and watch TV, they don't get out. And so we started a healthy living series with AARP for Fresh Air, Fitness, Friendship, and Fun, where once a month, seniors would come out. We do some introductions like stretching, a 1 or 2 mile walk, and then some sort of activity like plein air painting, or we had a drumming program. Tomorrow, we're bringing some seniors out to Fort Caroline National Memorial to have a ranger program, hike into history, if you will. During COVID, we had to do these on Zoom, but we are back to doing these in person. And this is a great way to get the seniors out, walking, talking, socializing, and having something to look forward to. We also, another one of our target audiences are the urban teens that we work with from Groundwork Jacksonville. Every summer they come out, they go kayaking. We do a nature study. This was, we have a naturalist that comes and, I mean, this is July and they're sitting here and it's buggy and it's hot and he has them mesmerized as far as, okay, listen to hear what you can, you know, hear. They take off the bandana and they have to look and, you know, really see what they can see. So it's an immersive type of nature program. And then they help us with service projects, where they get to meet different park personnel. So they're working with maintenance staff. They're working with the superintendent here. They're working with interpretation staff. so that they see that there's opportunities for possibly careers in the Park Service. We have a program with the youth with special needs. We have a garden out at Castaway Island Preserve. That we always do the planting with either DePaul School, which are students with, they're autistic and dyslexic. This year we did some planting with Foundation Academy, which is an alternative school. Again, kayaking is a great way to get kids outdoors, and it's different and it's kind of exciting. So we do the kayaking and the marine studies. And then we have a group of junior Civitan from the Northeast School of Special Education that come out and help us with a project, a fence clearing project at the Fort Caroline National Memorial every year. We're reaching out to military families. We were trying to get in with getting veterans out to help with some of our projects. But then another project that we have are for military youth and their families is our Junior Ranger Angler program, where we have fishing clinics. They go through a knot tying station, a casting station, ethical angling station, and then they actually get to fish. We have a beginning hiking women only. So like our trail explorations before, except now we're trying to, again, bring out those audiences that wouldn't necessarily be comfortable going out to the parks on their own. We have, like I said, the new area, the Seven Creeks Recreation Area. And I had a lot of women that said, oh, I want to go hiking, but I'm not going out there by myself. And so we've put together these programs with the North Florida Trailblazers to take women out, talking a little bit about what kind of footwear should you have? What should you have in your backpack? And then going for two or 3 mile walk. So let me look at the time. I think we have just a few minutes. So we have all these parks in Jacksonville. Those are the programs that we are working on now. Again, trying to use the parks to address issues of equity and health by providing access and opportunity to these different groups. But also I want to get back to now just looking at what do we have here in Jacksonville? What kind of parks do we have and what can you do if you want to come visit? So here's again the county, and we're going to start out in the northeast section with our coastal barrier islands. Big Talbot Island State Park, we call this Boneyard Beach. It's about a 3/4 mile walk from the parking area down to this very unusual beach where there's been a lot of erosion, and you get these, just the bones of these trees all on the beach. It's kind of magical. You feel like you're somewhere on vacation, somewhere else. They call it Black Rock Beach because the peat layer is kind of at the surface. So there's all these little tidal pools here. And you can see, I mean, we're there on a Saturday, and it's, some Saturdays it's very busy, other Saturdays it's not. There's a long, a 3 mile off-road trail on Big Talbot Island that runs along the length of Big Talbot Island that you can ride. There's a boardwalk section that overlooks the marsh. And then you can, if you're brave, go over the big bridge and go into Fernandina, and you have another 6 miles up to Fernandina Beach. Again, there's several overlooks over Spoonbill Pond. There's Little Talbot Island State Park. Again, just 3 miles of just pristine beach. And then Huguenot Memorial Park, which has the nesting terns. Fort George Island Cultural State Park is one, there's this gorgeous road that goes around the kind of the perimeter of the park, or within the park, but around the outside edge. The first thing you come to would be the Ribot Club, which is a 1930s resort. It was a golf club up into the 1980s, and then it fell into disrepair. The roof was caving in. It was terrible. And then the state National Park and City Parks all got together and were able to work together to get the funding to build it or renovate it back to its original glory. So now you can have a wedding there. We're going to have the Timaquan Science and History Symposium there at the end of this month. There's a little museum inside. Continuing around the corner, you come to Kingsley Plantation, one of the oldest plantations with a freestanding planter's house sitting on the Fort George River. The planter's house is exciting, but more exciting is this complex of slave cabins, 25 cabins in a half circle on site that are in, this one has been kind of renovated to look like, you know, it's a replica, but you have the original foundations of the other cabins. They do different programming at this place, but again, you can go and see how life was in the late 1800s. There's the historic Broward House. This is actually the Timaquan Parks Foundation headquarters. It's owned by the National Park Service. The two-story house, beautiful. If we move to the south side of the county, we have Fort Caroline National Memorial, again, a national park site. It's got a visitor center, as does Kingsley Plantation. It has a short walk down to a Timaquan hut recreation, and it has Fort Caroline National Memorial itself, the Fort Caroline replica there as well. And then it has like a 1 mile hike through there. Here's the hut. And they do programming here with Timaquan Parks Foundation volunteers to do Timaquan times. You know, how did the Native Americans live? What kind of tools did they use? What did they eat? Here's the replica of the fort, which is an exciting story of the French. Fort Caroline was here, was established a year before St. Augustine. And then there was skirmishes between the French and the Spanish took over. And it's kind of an exciting story. So lots of history in Jacksonville. Across the street from Fort Caroline National Memorial is the Theodore Roosevelt area. You are pretty much in, this one's one of the closest ones to the city. So you're kind of in neighborhoods. You hop out of your car and a very short walk and you are in the woods. Willie Brown lived there until the 1970s, and then he willed his property to the Nature Conservancy, which then went to the National Park Service. And so you have, I think it's 600 acres of this wooded property with a beautiful overlook. You walk to a large overlook that you climb up and you get great views of the marsh. Ready Point Preserve is the closest one we have to downtown. We have a long pier that goes out into the St. John's River, and there are trails to go hiking. It was supposed to be a neighborhood. We actually have a paved road here, but then it got preserved through the preservation project. And so there you have this large neighborhood park, again, wilderness park. Catherine Abbey Hanna Park is probably the best known city park that we have. It we like to say that you can do it all here. You can go hiking and biking and boating and fishing and kayaking and canoeing and bird watching and camping and disc golf, and it's right on the beach. It's a beautiful park. Again, with trails, you know, places to sit and just watch the wildlife, the clouds go by. Castaway Island, along the meandering estuarine San Pablo River, Castaway Island is a breezy spot to get away from the city and enjoy a breath of fresh air on a nature trail. Again, this is just another area that should have been developed but got snatched from the developers to become a neighborhood park. This is some 800 acres, I think, of mostly marsh. We do have a pollinator garden there that Again, we usually bring in students from Foundation Academy or DePaul School to help us with the planting. This little Girl Scout who helped us with the fencing. Dutton Island Preserve. Again, we just have park after park of just these wilderness trails with Dutton Island's about a mile and a half trail with several benches for overlooks on the marsh. And then areas to put in your kayak or go kayak camping. This is a fun place to camp if you've got a group. You reserve it through City of Atlantic Beach. At night they lock the gate and you have the island to yourself, so you can bring your canoes out and paddle around at night under the moonlight. Or we used to take the Boy Scouts there and play capture the flag. It's primitive camping within the city. It's a lot of fun. And then on the far south end, we have Julington Durbin Preserve, which is managed by the St. John's River Water Management District, Florida State Parks, and the City of Jacksonville. And it is a little island surrounded by Julington Creek and Durbin Creek. This particular property was, the developer wanted to put in, 5,000 homes or 500 homes or something a couple of years ago, and all of the park partners and the environmental organizations were able to stop that. On the west side, we have several parks. We have the Jacksonville Baldwin Rail Trail that we talked about earlier, which also has an equestrian component to it that runs along the side of the rail trail. We have Camp Milton Historic Preserve, which is a Civil War site. Once a year, they'll do living history days where they'll have a little minor Civil War skirmish and everybody gets dressed up and they show you the medical tortures of the day and how the cooking was done and sewing and things like that. Bulls Bay Preserve is just a small park that's used for biking mostly, but also hiking. It has a little waterfall. And then South Taylor Preserve, which helps connect Jennings State Forest, South Taylor Preserve, which will go up to Cecil Field Corridor, up to the Jacksonville Baldwin Rail Trail, and up to Cary State Forest. So the dream one day is to connect all of those parks. We have a couple of parks on the north here, but then we have the Seven Creeks Recreation Area, which is kind of our latest marketing branding, where we have a city park, Pumpkin Hill Creek Preserve State Park, Bogey Creek Preserve, which is North Florida Land Trust, Cedar Point Preserve, which is a city park, and the National Park Service's Cedar Point. All of these park partners have worked together to make this one big seamless experience. You can do the Seven Creeks Trail all the way from Betts Tiger Point down to Cedar Point. That's 7 miles. There's seven creeks, there's seven parks. We did have a big festival there again last weekend. Up on the north end, there's fishing and kayaking. Pumpkin Hill Creek State Park has trails, mostly equestrian trails, wildflowers. Cedar Point Preserve has beautiful trails to hike and bike. There's a bridge that connects Cedar Point Preserve, the city's Cedar Point Preserve, and the National Park Service's Cedar Point. And then the National Park Service's Cedar Point has this kind of hidden ruins that you go on one of the trails and, oh, there you go. There are some, the Fitzpatrick ruins. And their archaeology studies are being done now to try to find where there had to have been slave cabins associated with this small plantation. And so they've been looking for that. And then you continue on to the boat ramp at the end. So we have lots of parks to explore. We would encourage you to come visit us in Northeast Florida. Bring your bike or your hiking shoes or your kayak. And if you want to learn more, go to our website or give us a call.
All right. Thank you so much, Felicia. That was honestly, I'm planning my next trip to Jacksonville at this point. Right now, it looks like we have about 15 minutes for some questions. If anyone has any questions, please feel free to put them in the chat or just kind of unmute and ask your question. I know we do have one quick question from Deborah. She asks, is there a list anywhere of these areas that you're highlighting for reference? So where can she kind of go to find all of the amazing parks that you were talking about today?
Oh, absolutely. You want to go to timaquamparks.org. Let's see. That's good. I can bring up real quick. So this is our website. Again, we're getting ready to switch over, but over here on your parks, it has, you know, all the Timaquam parks and has a list. Let me go back. Here's the park map, and you know, it's interactive. So, you know, you like to go camping. So it lists the parks that you can camp at. The bicycling, you know, it doesn't tell you whether it's off-road or on-road, so you might have to dig a little deeper for that. That's a flaw, I think. You know, where can you go canoeing? And so then it lists the parks. You know, there's some water access for Julington, Durban. And then you would go to that, view that park page, and it has the details about, you know, there's a short video, there's a hiking project app, there's the address for putting in your kayak. Actually, this is the main entrance for hiking, and here's a couple of kayak launches. We have a really, our social media person puts great things on our Facebook and Instagram all the time. And I always worry because she does a lot of good stuff. And I, you know, if you're not on Facebook, you don't see it. But if you are on Facebook, that's a great, you know, join Timaquam Parks Foundation to get that kind of information. I should also mention we are a membership organization, so you are welcome to officially join as a member, be added to our e-newsletter. You get a great little bumper sticker. You can see me. And if you're interested in volunteering or just getting our e-newsletter, you can go to the Get Involved page, and that will volunteer, membership. We have a special places book that has pictures of all of our parks done by local photographer Will Dickey. Beautiful, nice Christmas present. Just saying.
Thank you for that. We do seem to have another question. This is more of like a technical question. For Hannah Park, is the entry fee, does that allow for re-entry in the same day, or do you have to repay every time you come and go, if that's some information that you would know?
So it says as you're leaving that you cannot come back. You know, I don't know whether if you went into the office and said, I've got to run out and do this, can I come back? They would let you back in. But I do know that the sign says when you're leaving, you're leaving.
Okay.
You would have to pay to get back in again.
So definitely a question to contact a park manager and ask them if there's any sort of like leeway on that.
Right. They have like a little office there you could go into. Mm-hmm. And they, you know, they might say no, but you know, I think it's always where, you know, don't ask, you don't get.
So. Absolutely. And again, if anyone has any questions, please feel free to put them into the chat and I will go ahead and relay those questions. I know after watching that presentation, I have a couple of questions. Working in outdoor recreation, something like inclusion and diversity and reaching these non-traditional audiences is something that we're seeing happen a lot more, and it's incredibly important, but a lot of people don't know where to start. I think it's easier to keep marketing to the same people who love our parks, which is amazing. But when we try to expand that reach, what was kind of the steps that you went through with the Timaquam Parks Foundation to figure out what were the best practices and how can we really make an impact to really have these people not just visit these parks once, but to continue to come back?
Right. So, I found that you can't just say, okay, we're gonna have this event, and we want this audience to come, and we're just going to open it to this audience, because they are not familiar and they're not going to come. You really have, it's the partnerships are critical. So when we wanted to reach, so we had talked about reaching out to these audiences, and then the lady from AARP came to us and said, we want to start doing these walks. And I was like, sure, sure. And then she said, no, I want to meet. I want to start doing these walks. And so you really have to go to where the people are, or work with those organizations that work with those people. Again, you know, you're not just going to walk into, So, so for the seniors, you know, we reached out to AARP. There's usually senior senior groups within the cities that work with seniors. We marketed to senior, like I said, Fleet Landing, which is a senior assisted living place. They always have an events coordinator. Working with the urban teens, that was also tough. We had grant money to bring teens out for fun programs, and you know, had the whole thing set up, and we had the volunteers all set up, and they said, we can't come after all because we don't have someone to bring them. And so in that case, you really need to find established groups that already, you got to do the low-hanging fruit start, you know, that already meet, and then offer an opportunity to that particular group to come out, and then market that, you know, do press releases on that so that other groups see that and say, I want to do that. With the special needs kids, we went to the different schools to see, you know, to talk to who works with those children and would be willing to bring a group out. I'm trying to think also, the Beginning Hiking Women Only, we've worked with the Jacksonville Women's Center, which has since given us information about the PACE Center for Girls. You know, they know the other groups that are working with these groups. It really helped at the beginning, especially with the health, to get into the health community, because you're meeting with the different organizations that work with different populations. A lot of the health issues that we have, you know, they're focusing on downtown groups. And so that was, to go to those meetings, you met with a lot of those downtown partners and the people who actually work with the people that you're trying to reach. Military, we're trying to get into the military. And so that is reaching out to the different military MWR groups, working with schools where, like, we have a couple of schools that are right by the bases. So working with teachers to see if they can bring groups out. It's, like I said, it is easier to work with who you know, but sometimes you have to, and sometimes you start out with working with, you know, our first senior program that we did, the first Healthy Living, I wasn't sure who was going to come because I thought ARP was going to bring a group. And then she said, oh no, I just send it out to all our people. And we know that doesn't necessarily work because people aren't going to necessarily come. So I was at church talking to every old person I knew, including myself, to come to this program. And so it ended up being, you know, so several people from church came, then they brought friends, and then yeah, we did get people from the AARP, and they all became friends, and then so then it sort of snowballs from there. But yeah, getting started is tough. You have to get, you have to go where. You also have to have funding, because a lot of these groups can't get out to a park that's 20 minutes away. And so we get fund, we write grants to reach out to these groups that'll provide bus transportation, which isn't cheap. It costs $480 for us to bring two groups of urban kids out to our Seven Creeks Festival last weekend. And so there are costs associated with that. But partnerships are the big thing. Partnering with experts that can make your program more interesting, partnering with these different groups that actually work with We're not a women's organization, but we can partner with groups that do work with women that can help bring women to our program.
Absolutely. So partnerships definitely key when it comes to creating new audiences. And you kind of touched upon the importance of funding and securing that funding to be able to provide for these groups, because there's obviously barriers for why they haven't come to the park in the past. When you go about finding new funding sources, how do you do that? Because I think that's a question that everyone always wants to know. For whatever program they're trying to get started off the ground, it always comes down to funding. So what are some of the best practices that Tim McOwan Parks Foundation uses as far as finding new funding sources and securing that necessary funding to expand that reach?
So that was part of why we started a health initiative, I have to say, is because we were always writing grants to the same environmental groups. And so, they see many things come across, there are just not that many organizations that are funding environmental projects necessarily. But we have a big health community here. And so they have a vested interest in helping improve the health of the community. And so having that, being able to market the parks as a health venue is just a little bit different. And it really, it really helps to make your program more relevant than we're just going to go out and be in nature. Well, why? Because it can really improve mental and physical health in a tangible way. And so now your opportunities to get grants are a little bit better than they were when you were just saying we're going for a walk in the park.
That is completely understandable. Kind of reaching new audiences seems to be the consistent key. If there's anyone else who has any questions in the chat, please feel free to put them in. If not, thank you so much, Felicia, for spending some time with us today and give us some information on the Tim McOwan Parks Foundation, all of these amazing parks. If anyone would like, we have been recording this webinar. So if you want to rewatch it, get some more information, or share it with your friends, please do so. We'll be sending out the link to the recording this Friday. We will also have a brief survey that we'll be sending out later today so we can figure out how our office can better serve you and how we can bring you the topics in these webinars that you are going to find the most helpful. And in the email, we will also include a link to the Tim McOwan Parks Foundation website so that you can get all of the information and start planning your next trip to Jacksonville so you can visit all of these parks and try and figure out how you can do it all in one weekend, because I know that's what I'll be doing later today. I'll kind of give it another minute for any last questions. Thank you again to everyone for joining us today. And if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to the Office of Greenways and Trails. I'm going to go ahead and put that email address in the chat. So if you have any questions, like I said, please feel free to reach out to us there. And I will also put the Tim McOwan Parks Foundation website in our chat.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for joining us. I know that I was unaware of all the amazingness coming from South Florida. I really had Jacksonville seemed so far away to me, but the information today makes me want to spend my 2 hours from Tallahassee to Jacksonville and hop on over now.
That's right.
All right. So I think that's all the questions we have for today. Thank you again, Felicia, for coming and spending some time with us. And I hope everyone has a wonderful rest of their day.
Excellent. Thanks a lot, Michaela.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.